Hey, it's Steve. This is day three of my 30 days of video series, and also I'm starting day three of my water fasting, so I haven't had any food in about 2 days now. I've gone about almost 48 hours so far without food, and the third day of the fast, which I'm just starting today, is normally the hardest. I just know that from experience from the fast I did last year. So my energy is pretty low right now. I feel like I'm working with like 20 to 30% of the muscle strength I normally have. I woke up in a cold sweat this morning, had really bad breath, bad body odor. So it's like I could tell my body's kicking into detoxification mode. Mentally, I feel fine. Emotionally, I feel good. But physically, I just feel like I'm really tired, really low energy. My body temperature dropped a bit normally. You know, normal body temperature is 98.6. I usually run a little bit cooler, like 98.4, 0.5. This morning I was, after I was up for an hour, I checked my body temperature and it was 97.8. So I'm feeling a little cold. My hands are freezing. I'm wearing a hoodie right now just to stay warm. I've got the heat cranked up in the house a little higher than normal. The fireplace going in the background and, just trying to stay warmer. The third day of a fast is typically the most difficult. It's because, the first few days you start fasting, your body is gradually using up all the short-term energy reserves it has, such as the glycogen in your muscles. And as those get depleted, it takes a little while for it to ramp up into providing you with enough energy just from burning your fat reserves without having any food intake at all. And so, especially day two, day three, get extra hungry, just like having all these food cravings. But I know from experience that that'll pass. And so probably sometime tomorrow I'll start feeling better and my body will be, finally adapting to being in a long-term fasting mode. And that's where it gets a lot easier because the hunger goes away. So today I just kind of like, it's just gonna be an endurance thing, just making it hour by hour, getting through it. Usually I find that the afternoons are harder than the mornings. In the afternoon yesterday, I was like super hungry, just constantly thinking about food, going hour by hour and not having much energy. I've also reached the point in the fast where when I stand up now, I have to like do it slowly because when I'm sitting down or lying down or laying on the couch or whatever, my body's in a lower energy state and it takes a little bit more time for my body to ramp up and transition to giving me the energy to have for standing or moving around. So when I stand up, and this will probably be true throughout the rest of the fast, when I stand up, I have to like stand up slowly and grab onto something, hold onto a couch or a chair or a table or something, and wait for like 5 to 10 seconds. Because initially, when I stand up, I'll get a bit dizzy and my vision may cut out, my vision will black out for a couple seconds as if I'm getting a little bit faint. And then it will stabilize and then I can start moving. And once I'm in motion, once I'm standing up and moving around, I'm usually okay for a bit. Today it's going to be extra low energy. Getting out of bed this morning was like super difficult. It felt like gravity had been turned up to triple its normal level. I just felt like my muscles were so weak. I had to sit up first, like wait a minute, breathe. Just breathing felt a bit labored. And then, gradually stand up, hold on to something, and then I could start moving. And then my body gradually gives me more energy. It's almost like, when you're when your devices, like your laptop, goes into low power mode because you're not using it much, so it blinks the screen. It's kind of like your body's doing that same kind of thing. It gets into an energy conservation mode. And so it only gives you like a minimum amount of energy you need to do things. I noted like last time I was fasting, even at certain points in the fast, my mind would feel very blank, like my body wasn't wasting extra energy on thought. I would have to consciously push my mind to think about certain things, like if I wanted to write an article. It wouldn't just happen automatically. It was almost like pushing through some kind of resistance where it didn't want to use energy unless it absolutely had to. Otherwise, I'm doing okay. I think I'll make it through this part of the fast. I know it's probably going to be pretty difficult this afternoon. Just have to go hour by hour. But I also know from experience it'll get easier. And it gets a lot easier when the hunger goes away. So that'll probably happen sometime tomorrow. When the hunger is gone and you're not thinking about food all the time, then you just have to get used to the, having physically lower energy. But otherwise, you can probably go for weeks on a fast. And I'll see what that's like. Again, my aim is to try to go for 30 days this time, but if my body tells me I better stop, I'm gonna stop. So that's an update on the fasting. What I mainly want to talk about in this video is this idea of life purpose. And I want to share a way of thinking about life purpose that is not very commonly shared, at least from all that I've read and seen about it. And not really something I've mentioned too much myself either, but something I think is a really powerful angle to get clearer on your sense of purpose in life. And, you know, say the purpose for your career, your business, if you have a business, what you want to do in your life that has some deeper meaning for you other than just like working on fulfilling your own needs and, you know, taking care of maybe your material wants, things like that. And, you know, typically when you do like life purpose exercises, and I've done many of them, but, you know, read books on the subject and been to workshops where this sort of thing was covered. The people who teach this often, you know, take you in certain directions where they'll go and delve into your past and like, what did you like when you were a kid? You know, what were your dreams when you were a kid? And that's one angle they'll take. What's another angle? Another angle they'll take is like, what do you love doing? You know, what most inspires you? What makes you happiest in life? And yet another angle is like a spiritual perspective. Like you try to meditate on it and you get some spiritual insights, or you talk to your guides, or you go to a psychic medium and get counseling. And, you know, they try to give you a sense of which direction your life purpose is in. And another angle, of course, is just, you know, getting experience and trying to be of service and seeing what shows up. And I find there's some gems there, some truth that can be helpful in discovering your life purpose. But it's not really how it showed up for me. And I think when it really shows up in a powerful way, what people are missing most of the time when they take these other angles, to delving into life purpose based on your path, your skills, what you love doing, or that spiritual perspective, is they're missing one of the most powerful aspects of life purpose and what makes it feel really deeply meaningful and exciting, and where the passion comes from and where that drive and motivation comes from. And it's the people. It's the people that you're serving. Life purpose, ultimately, is a social pursuit. Because if you're going to take on a purpose that's grand in some way, where you're thinking big, it's a vision that's more than just about you, there are going to be other people involved in that. People you serve, people who become part of your team, people who encourage you, mentors you connect with along the way. And that is going to become a big part of your life. The social landscape that you create is a huge part of your life purpose. So let's say you start off with something, you know, like you start off with a business idea and you're doing it because you think it sounds like a cool business idea. What you may not consider carefully enough when you're first starting is that the customers and the suppliers and the other business partners that business is going to need to thrive, those people will become an integral part of your social landscape for years, maybe even for decades if you continue running the business for a while. If you go to work for some company and you choose a career path in that direction, the people, you know, your coworkers, your boss, the organization itself, the customers and the clients you have to deal with, those people are going to be part of your social landscape for a long time. And one of the most disheartening things that people hate is when they take a job, you know, for reasons of like, it's a cool thing they want to do career-wise, or it was good good pay, or it seemed like it was a, you know, great opportunity in a variety of ways, like it might help them advance or learn skills. And what often brings them down the most, probably like 80% of the time, of what they're going to complain about is that the people they have to work with, the boss that doesn't understand them or appreciate them, the coworkers they feel disconnected from, the customers and the clients they just have a hard time caring about. And you know, by extension also, the systems they have to deal with that are created by people, people that may not have the same values they do. And I hear this especially a lot from people in their 20s and 30s. They, you know, one of their greatest terrors is having to get a corporate job that just disempowers them and makes them feel uninspired and feels like they're just spinning their wheels. And what brings them down most about that tends to be the people that are a mismatch for them. Let's say you start a cookie business, like you love baking and you like cookies. Okay, and you think, hey, this would be a cool thing. Like, everybody loves my cookie recipes, so I want to make cookies. And so you start a business based on that. What you might want to consider carefully is that then your life is going to be filled eventually with people who work in the, you know, supply. It's people who are going to supply your cookie ingredients. you'll have to, you know, create good relationships there. People who are going to be customers of cookies. In other words, your life is going to be filled with cookie lovers. Now, for some people, that may be great. You may think, I would love to be in a social landscape of having more cookie lovers in my life. I would love to be getting emails and support requests and feedback and testimonials from people who love cookies. And, you know, that is what your life is going to be about socially for many, many years. Now, of course, you can have friends off on the side, but, we tend to have a lot of, social influx into our life through our career paths, through the work we do. Whether you run a business or you work for somebody else, a big part of your social landscape is going to be connected to your work and your career. Who may not come into your life because of running that cookie business? Well, people who don't eat cookies are probably not going to be as big a part of your life. And that may include a lot of health conscious people who just decide for whatever reason, it's the fat, the sugar, the processed ingredients, they don't want to have cookies in their life. And so those people will not necessarily be a big part of your life. Or they may just, avoid dealing with your business, and so they avoid coming into your social sphere. Now, I'm not, intending this to cast a judgment on you if you want to run a cookie business. If that's what you want to do, great. So the idea here is to think carefully about what kinds of people you most want to have in your life. Like, what would create the richest social life for you? And I sort of stumbled upon this, this way of thinking. It sort of evolved over a long period of time. My first business was working in computer games. And so I attracted a lot of gamers into my life as customers. And also, eventually, later on, working with other game developers as I branched out and got more involved in the industry. And then, by extension, software developers, too. And those were, in many ways, cool people to deal with. Like, I liked the types of gamers I had to deal with. And in fact, I found that as my games evolved, like I started off with these action arcade games type of things in my business, and then gradually evolved into doing more cerebral games like puzzle games, especially nonviolent games I really got into. And I noticed I attracted different types of customers, and the social landscape of my life, at least with the people I was dealing with online, changed a bit. The action game customers tended to be just not as pleasant or not as fun to deal with. They tended to be more competitive types of people, because you're going for things like high scores and stuff like that. And the puzzle game customers, they tended to be much more heart-centered, more friendly, and by and large, I found them smarter people to deal with. I got emails, that I didn't expect. Like, I got emails from grandparents who were playing my games with their grandkids, and how it was like a family bonding experience for them to play together, and they really liked some of the characters. I started getting fan art from people. Kids would, draw characters like either on the computer or like in crayon or marker or something, and they'd send it to me either by mail or by, emailing to me. And I thought, this is cool. Like, I've got some aspect of community going here. But it wasn't super like amazing or inspiring to me. I didn't hang out with these people in person for the most part, like pretty much hardly ever, unless I ran into somebody who was a fan at a conference or something like that. I actually found it more inspiring as I went along to work with the game developers and the programmers and the designers, because I found these are people more like me. They're the creative types. And that's what encouraged me to get into writing articles more when I started doing it. I started doing that in 1999. So for 5 years before I started blogging, I was writing articles on the side to help out other game developers and other software developers. And I liked dealing with those kinds of people. I started a roundtable, a discussion forum I hosted a few times at the Game Developers Conference. I spoke at some other conferences too, and participated on roundtable panels or hosted a group discussion, and I loved that. I loved that. I remember at the Game Developers Conference, this was probably over 15 years ago. We would not get much respect back then as indie developers. I think that's probably changed a bit since then. But we would get like what was arguably the worst time slot of the conference. So we would get it on the last day, like Sunday, Sunday late afternoon or early evening when everybody else was like leaving early. And I would take advantage of that though, because we'd have an hour-long session and we'd get maybe 30 people, in there discussing various aspects of game development. And it was really cool. And I would just like sit in a chair and kind of keep the discussion going and bring up some topics, and we'd all, you know, share ideas. And it was a great time in that field where we were all figuring out how to, you know, how to monetize this medium, and how to make our games better, and how to get, you know, better at what we were doing. And what was cool is that, you know, since we were the last session, and the hour was up, I told people, you know what, nobody else needs this room afterwards. We were in a big conference center in a convention center downtown somewhere. I think it was in San Jose. I think it was a couple of years we did that. And I would tell people, like, hey, let's just keep hanging out if you guys want to keep talking and keep sharing until they, you know, kick us out. And so we would just like stay there for 2-3 hours. Until finally the cleaning crew would come in and say, okay, you guys got to go now. We'd be like, okay. And about half the people would stay, you know, well past that first hour. And then people would sort of drift out as they had to go, like if they had a flight or something. And that was really cool. And I just, you know, I realized I loved working with the developers more than I liked working with the customers that I had. And I thought, okay, one way, that's a bit of a sad realization. Like, shouldn't I love my own customers more than technically I'm helping out competitors? But I just found it so much more inspiring. I liked the people. They were creative, you know, interesting, geeky. And, you know, I found that our conversations were just so much more in-depth. But I felt like, you know, there was yet another step beyond that. And as I went along writing these articles, I began broadening them a bit, because I would start writing about topics that were of interest to game developers and software developers, like overcoming procrastination or you know, working with teams or getting organized and, you know, having some structure in your day, things like that. And as I'd write about these topics, I would attract people outside that industry would come to read my articles, and I started getting feedback from a broader population. And so I thought, huh, why not help more people? So I started writing about broader topics. And sometimes I'd still use gaming industry and software development examples, but I could broaden the topics beyond that. And that was really what started building my traffic. And eventually got to the point where my games website, you know, that was mainly about selling the games, and I was publishing other developers' games too. And so at one point I had up to about 24 games that we were selling. And in another section of the website that I wasn't really promoting, I put up these articles. I used to publish them in a trade newsletter, but people would, you know, want to have permanent links to them, so I just put up an archives on my website. And eventually got to the point where my articles were getting more traffic to them than my games were. And I thought, huh, that's interesting too. And partly that's because I started writing these articles in 1999, and Google started in 1998. So I was getting these articles seeded in Google. You know, I was ranking like number one on some of these great search terms, like overcoming procrastination. I think I ranked number one on that for years. And so Google was just sending me tons and tons of traffic from people searching on these topics. And I thought, interesting. And so that's what one of the things that encouraged me to transition full time into blogging was that I liked the people that I was attracting so much more. As I began broadening the topics I wrote about, I began attracting not just gaming and software developers, but more broadly, people who were personal growth enthusiasts, people who wanted to grow and improve, to build their courage, to get stronger, you know, mentally and emotionally in their lives, to do something more meaningful with their lives. And especially a lot of people wanted to do something, you know, with an online business, people who are looking for an alternative to like the meaningless corporate job route that a lot of people were just trying to get away from. And I found that, you know, over time, as I started connecting more and more with this audience, I just loved it more. I loved the people. I just felt so inspired by them and who they were. And eventually, I think it was started doing meetups in person like around 2006, 2007. And when I had a chance to meet these people in person and hang out with them, I just like fell in love with the people. And that's what became a much bigger part of my purpose. And when I would blog, when I'd write articles, or do workshops or give talks, it was always focused on the people that I was serving. And I have to say, you know, in 12 and a half years of blogging and writing hundreds and hundreds of articles and a book, I've never had writer's block. And I think the reason I've never had writer's block is that I focus on writing for the people. Like when I'm creating this video too, when I create the videos in the series, I know I'm not going to be blocked at all. Why? Because I know the people. I meet them in person too. Like there's a meeting in person page on my website where I, you know, offer to meet up in person with everybody who wants to come to Vegas at some point. They want to, you know, get together and meet in person. We go to Starbucks, we sit down, we chat for a couple hours. And I've got a meetup tomorrow morning I'll be doing with three people who are coming to Vegas. Now, people don't normally come to Vegas just for these meetups, although that has happened a few times before. People have even flown internationally just to do one of these meetups. But mostly it's, you know, Vegas attracts people who come here for some reason or another, like vacation or a conference or a wedding. And then they carve out a few hours to come out to my side of town and we meet up for a bit. And, I do that because I like the people. I really like the people that are in my audience, that are fans of personal growth. We have a lot in common. So we often have these really easy, natural flowing discussions. It's not like pulling teeth. And it's great. It's just, you know, finding the types of people I like being around. Another thing is that by getting into public speaking, I got to hang out with a lot of speakers. And speakers tend to be very growth-oriented people because almost all of them were at some point afraid of public speaking and they had to push through that fear. And they're often wanting to get better and they're into serving people and making a difference. And so we have a lot in common with our values. So that's another positive thing that came into my life. As I got more into lifestyle design, I had the opportunity to connect more with people who are into that as well, like people who enjoy traveling a lot. I often hang out with different friends I've made around the world when I travel, and that's great too. And so what I've found is that my purpose, my sense of purpose in life, has been really rooted in serving certain types of people. Like, you have to know that you can't possibly serve, you know, all the 7+ billion people on the planet. You know, that's not your audience. Even if you have a huge mega corporation, you're not going to reach everybody. And on a personal level, you know, the people you serve are, they're going to be much closer to you in your life. Like, who are you seeing each day? Who are you connecting with online each day? Who are these people that are in your life? So I would suggest, you know, that you could get much more leverage from this idea of life purpose if you focus more deeply on what kinds of people you want to serve and what kind of social landscape you want to create. And realize, you know, that if you start any kind of business, say you start a consulting business, you're going to attract a social landscape that'll become your social life, a big part of it at least, the clients that you attract for that type of business. So if you say you become a web consultant, then your life becomes filled with people who need websites and who want websites and who work on websites. If that's something that inspires you, great. But if you'd rather have a rich social life filled with a different type of person, then I would suggest creating a business that will attract those types of people or work for a company that attracts those types of people. So they'll be your coworkers or your clients, your customers, your boss. Those will be the types of people you get to deal with each day. So there's definitely, you know, many career paths out there that would just make me cringe and probably would make you cringe too if you think about the types of people they'll bring into your life. And generally what I find people are really out of alignment with a sense of purpose, it's because the social landscape that they've fallen into is just deeply uninspiring to them. They're just like, you know, this is not my tribe. These are not my people. That's what they're thinking. When you find your tribe, that's what like seriously just lights you up inside. And, I often write articles thinking of certain people or maybe a few people. And I'm doing the same thing with doing videos. I often think of people in mind. I've met hundreds and hundreds of people from my audience, from my readers on my blog. People who've come to Vegas and we've done meetups, people I've met with while traveling, where we've done just having an announced meetup at a certain time and place in some cities. You know, I've done them in, especially in North America and in Europe and various cities there. And, also at the workshops I've done. So, from meeting all these people, I've just learned, you know, who they are, what their problems and challenges are, and how I can serve them. And, as an example, yesterday, when I posted video 2, I noticed a comment from Chris, who's a somebody I met up with a while ago. And, Chris was giving some positive feedback on the video. And what he may not realize is I was actually thinking about him specifically when I created that video. And I do that quite often. You know, I often think about certain specific people when I write an article or create, as I'm doing now, creating a video. And so it's not necessarily a coincidence that you might see yourself represented in that article if we've met before. That, I think, is what, you know, creates just an absolutely tremendous amount of inspiration and positive flow in life, is really focusing on the social landscape. That's where so much of my motivation comes from. And when you find that you're really in resonance with this audience, you know, with your audience, one of the amazing things is that you're going to kick into this mutual appreciation cycle, where I really appreciate my audience and what they do for my life and all the goodness they bring into my life, and they appreciate what I'm doing for them as well. And when you have that positive appreciation, it's such a beautiful thing. I wanted to show you an example, you know, just like to give you like more of a physical idea. This is a file folder that's filled with like cards and letters I received over the years from people. You know, like some of them typewritten letters, some of them, you know, handwritten letters, just, you know, saying like what they've appreciated about my work. People putting in, you know, postcards and, you know, mailing me things from different places. Yeah, it's like more postcards, thank you cards. And, you know, these have come in over, you know, a long period of time, mostly from the early years I was blogging, where I would publish my address on my website. But it's just like, you know, just, you know, cards and letters. And sometimes people would include cash in these too, like $10, $20, sometimes a couple hundred dollars. And just like, you know, on and on and on, you know, more thank you cards. Sometimes people would include CDs or books that they'd written, and they told me my work inspired them to do that. And, you know, like here's a CD from somebody in here. And I keep all these, and it's, if I ever, you know, I've never gone back and reread all these, but if I ever felt like I wasn't making enough of a difference in people's lives, I would go back and probably, you know, reread these and just to re-inspire myself. Here's a drawing somebody made of me. I think this was when I gave a speech. So kind of see the likeness there. I think that's kind of cool. You know, so when you have people that you really resonate with, and they're just expressing all this appreciation for you, you know, it really makes a difference. Here's kind of a funny one. I especially appreciate the creative ones. Somebody sent me a letter. They wrote this letter on the back of a cereal box. So it's a Cheerios box, you know, Cheerios box here. And one of the reasons they did that is because I had, you know, mentioned in my blog that when I was in high school, I used to do, you know, homework in creative ways, like for my calculus class. And one of the things I would do is, you know, take a cereal box and do my homework on the back of it and turn that in. And, you know, I had a very forgiving teacher who was, you know, I was a bit eccentric back then. Maybe I still am, but just in different ways. And, you know, so the fact that I mentioned that in my blog, somebody picked up on that and wrote me a letter like that. So I really appreciate that. You know, the people I like working with, they're growth-oriented. They have a playful side to them too. They don't want to go the corporate enslavement route. They want to do something meaningful and purposeful with their lives as well. They care about the planet. They're probably not of a nationalist mindset, you know, like they're very unlikely to be in the mindset like we should all just like have our walled countries. You know, they're probably thinking more globally, like we want to do things that are good for the planet. Especially people that travel a lot. I travel a lot myself. I tend not to think of myself as an American. I think of myself as a citizen of the world. I really don't like what's happening in the USA right now, where it seems like we're going down the wrong direction, you know, putting up more barriers and more walls, you know, both physically, potentially, and metaphorically. I just think that's the wrong way to go. And so, the types of people I attract tend to resonate with that message. Another thing I found with this idea of life purpose is that if I express more of who I am, I naturally repel people who are not a good match for me. And I found that, you know, a lot of times in business, people try to cater to everyone. They want to be everybody's match. And they're afraid of turning anybody away. They don't want to say or do anything that would offend anyone. And I say, you know, I understand that. But I say it's a lot more effective to go ahead and just be fully yourself and just offend the heck out of people that you don't want to work with anyway. And I do that a lot. There's an article I wrote a while ago called Ones and Tens, where I kind of mentioned that idea. And it's so much more effective because then it eventually filters out all the people who don't resonate with your message and who you're not going to want to work with anyway. Or you're going to always have to wear a mask or pretend to be somebody you're not in order to do business with them or connect with them or work with them. And you know, one of the reasons I run my own business is I feel like probably be a bad match for working with a boss because I'm too independent minded. It would be really hard for me to just have somebody else telling me what to do all the time. I want to do my own creative projects and choose what I'm going to do each day. I want to take time off whenever I want and not have somebody else dictate my vacation time. If I want to take off the next month, I'm going to take off the next month. And so, consequently, I need an audience that understands that about me and that's very forgiving and that they're okay with me following my lifestyle desires. So, like last year, my girlfriend Rochelle and I spent 30 days in a row going to Disneyland. And if anybody has an issue with that and they think that's a bad thing for me to do, and I got a lot of interesting insights out of doing that crazy experiment, then they should just leave and not be part of my audience. You know, I want to connect with the people who like me as I am and who can appreciate me as I am and appreciate me for what I do. And if my life is filled with those people, I'm going to appreciate them too, and I'm going to feel really driven and motivated to serve them because I really like them and I really care about them. I like people who are generous. I like being generous. All my blog posts are uncopyrighted and they're donated to the public domain. All the videos I'm making on YouTube, this whole video series, it's all uncopyrighted and I'm donated to the public domain. So you can share the heck out of it, whatever you like, create derivative works based on it, repackage it, translate it, do whatever you like with it. I'm totally fine with that because that's the kind of person I am. So who else wouldn't be a good match for that type of person? Somebody who's going to drain me dry, you know, somebody who just wants to take value from me and never give anything in return and never put out positive ripples in the world. Never creating a mutual flow. If it's that kind of person, like, given that I put out internet content, that's not really an issue. They can, you know, people like that can read the content. But if it's somebody that just wants to take, I'm not going to be the kind of person who's going to sacrifice all kinds of richness and goodness for my own life to serve somebody who's just going to be an energy vampire. And so I want to repel those types of people as well. I want to attract more people who are naturally generous and they appreciate my generosity, and that creates a beautiful mutual flow. And that, you know, that makes me much more motivated to want to serve those people because I feel like I'm supported in what I'm doing. Is this beginning to make sense? You know, that the social landscape you create becomes an integral part of your life purpose. It becomes really the centering force that drives you and that motivates you. I think it's really tough to try to get a clear sense of life purpose if you're constantly trying to figure it out in a vacuum, like you're just journaling about it, coming up with the ideas. I would instead suggest starting with the people, you know, focusing on what kind of social landscape you want to have in your life. Who do you want to have as people in your life? Do you want your life to be filled with people who love traveling? Do you want to be filled with people who love cookies? Do you want to be filled with people who are super, super healthy? Do you want it to be filled with, yoga enthusiasts? Do you want it to be filled with people who are entrepreneurs? Whatever you types of people you like, and that may take some exploration to figure out, consider creating a career or a business that will increase the volume of such people in your life and really allow you to develop deeper connections with them. That has been something I stumbled upon just sort of, in an evolutionary process. But if I were gonna start over on a new path and do it deliberately, and like if I were designing a new business or a new career path for myself starting over today, I would begin with the people. I would think very carefully about what kind of social life and social landscape I would wanna create for myself. And then I'd design a business or pick a career path where my life would be rich in such people. So I wanted to share this, you know, this message with you because I think it's a really cool way and a really empowering way to think about life purpose, and it's where so much motivation comes from. So I hope you'll give some thought to this and maybe give it some reflection, especially if this has been a part of your life that's been a bit of a struggle for you.